Tuesday morning, WCLU says good morning to you, and thank you for turning on the radio. We enjoy our little chat we have each and every day on a program we call The Archives. It's 100 years worth of history, but Sam Terry is with me today, and Sam, coming up on Thursday of this week, there's a big activity that's going on that you have graciously agreed to be a big part of. It's the 225th birthday of the city of Glasgow. It's a Thursday and Friday type of event, but the big news is that on Thursday evening at 6 p.m., Sam Terry is going to be presenting in the council chambers some fabulous history about the city of Glasgow. And I understand, even with the aid of some PowerPoint materials, is that right?
Yes, we do have some maps and photographs and drawings that we will take a look at as a part of that program to learn about why our ancestors came here to begin with.
And that's going to be at 6 p.m. in the council chambers. And we've mentioned this some. It's so monumental. I'm not really sure I can accurately describe it, but we have City Clerk Mona Simmons has been making sure that a lot of the early documents involved with the beginning of Glasgow were in a state of preservation, putting them in those sleeves and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. And that has been completed to the point that we're going to be able to show those off up in the council chambers as a part of that event on Thursday evening.
It should be fascinating to see. And, that's a good reminder that, you know, we have sort of two beginnings for uh-huh. Glasgow. We have one from 1799 when the place was created and established, and then years and years and years later, the town was growing and it became classified as a city mm-hmm. and became an incorporated city and took on a whole new persona in the way its local government was organized. And so Mona's done a wonderful job to gather those records and preserve them for the future.
Hope to see a good crowd because you're going to get kind of like the greatest hits of Sam Terry.
Well, I'm not sure, but we'll certainly have something that will be informative.
It'll be good. Let's go back 100 years. This is a fascinating story in the Glasgow Republican from 1924. Some of the things you got to deal with in the city world. Dr. A.T. Botts possibly holds the rat-catching record for Glasgow. And sure of his methods that part of Glasgow has been blacklisted by union rats. Those who work the night shifts only and weigh 1.5 pounds and up. One catch last week, numbered 9, and the trap was so full, owing to the size of the rats, they could hardly move. Several have been caught since in singles and pairs and trios until there are no more to catch. Dr. Botts has the thanks of all of his neighbors and the everlasting enmity of the rats.
My goodness.
So we had, 100 years ago, we had a rat problem?
We apparently did.
What kind of a physician was Dr. A.T. Botts?
He was a local surgeon. And Dr. Botts lived on South Green Street in the home many people will recognize as the home of Mr. and Ms. Cecil Wilson, uh-huh. and later their daughter, Cecile Wilson Garman, and her mm-hmm. husband, Larry. Beautiful Gothic Revival home there, and apparently the neighborhood had a rat problem,
That's
a big
right.
rat problem.
Yeah. Dr. Botts says, I'll show these rats. But it's a part of the history, you know. What do you say? The ones that work at night that are over 1.5 pounds.
Yes.
Those, they come out at night, huh? Gosh. Kind of an eerie thought, isn't it? This was the day in 1934 that Miss Timmons has been declared the beauty contest winner. We're talking about Miss Louise Timmons, chosen as Miss Glasgow and later as Miss Third District to represent this district in the American Legion Beauty Pageant next August at Ashland. In the Miss Glasgow contest, Miss Madeline St. Charles was the runner-up, and Miss Mary Elizabeth Grinstead was third. Now, those are some lovely ladies in 1934.
Mm-hmm. Indeed.
Who, to win the Miss Glasgow competition. I bet that could be competitive,
yeah,
don't you think?
It could be. And things like beauty pageants were just getting a start at that point. Yeah. They weren't typical things around yeah. here.
Got lots of good coverage, though. 1944, Mrs. Carl Walbert has been appointed the manager of the Sinclair Bulk Station here, replacing her husband, who leaves today for service with the Armed Forces. With the appointment by the Sinclair Company, Mrs. Walber becomes the first feminine bulk gas oil agent in this district. You know, I haven't seen it phrased that way before.
Well, I have a feeling the newspaper writer wasn't sure how to phrase
that's
that.
Right. That's right. Today we'd say just the first female bulk yes. gas oil agent in the district.
But she was
feminine as well, as I recall.
Indeed, and I'm sure she did a fabulous job with
yeah,
that.
That's right.
But kind of interesting to see women taking over their husbands' positions while they were gone to serve in the war, in World War II.
Yeah, that is, you had to...
Everybody had a part.
Everybody had a part, and, you know, that was just the price of winning the war. If you had to take over the bulk oil company, that was what you did. 1954, interesting story in the Glasgow Times and Evening Journal about Adolf Hitler's personal armored automobile called the Great Mercedes, built especially for the Nazi tyrant, will be presented in Glasgow May the 10th and the 11th under the sponsorship of the Disabled American Veterans. How about that? I never knew that happened.
I never heard of this.
Okay, this is you've seen pictures of Hitler in that big Mercedes. Mm-hmm. Well, following the custom of dictators, Hitler demanded the biggest and best for himself. It was built in Stuttgart, Germany, using slave labor. The 20-foot-long car weighs 10,000 pounds, 2,000 of that being half-inch steel armored plates and an inch and a quarter bulletproof glass. It can cruise, Sam, at 90 miles an hour. And with a supercharger, it'll do better than 135. The capacity of the gas tank is 56 gallons. It gets about 3 or 4 miles per gallon, it says here. Fate has deemed that the very subject of Hitler's follow is now used by people that he hoped to conquer, to raise funds for useful purposes, not for conquest. The exhibit will be located at Washington and Green Streets and open to the public. Well, that would have been right down there, right where the Morris Building was, right?
The Morris Building and Citizens Bank and George J. Ellis Drugs. So somewhere in that corner, Hitler's Mercedes was going to be on display.
I wonder if there's any pictures of that.
It would be interesting to know.
And it would be also interesting to know is who brought it, and did they charge to see it, or was it just like a patriotic thing? We got some more research to
do. Right. Maybe somebody will call and tell us.
Can you imagine if that car that weighs... How much did we say it was?
Well, we didn't say how heavy it was, yeah. but it had to be heavy, and it could cruise at 90 miles an hour.
That's right. So
My
if
goodness.
It did hit something, it's going to take it out.
Not to mention it was 20 feet long.
Well, anyway, but I'm sure it brought a lot of people to see it. This was the day in 1964 that Keith's Grocery was under construction on Cleveland Avenue, just west of the bypass. It'll be operated by Mr. and Ms. Clyde Keith. It is now the home of Annie's Restaurant. And I remember Keith's Grocery out there. And it was this is 1964, neighborhood groceries were the thing. And the Keith mm-hmm. ran a nice one over there, too. And it's still being used for excellent purpose there at Annie's Restaurant.
Neat local history.
1974, the Glasgow Times reporting that Ruth Jean Sharp, Linda Harlow, Dorothy Payne, Clarice Martin, and Rita Elmore are members of the Glasgow bowling team, which is the tournament leader at a big tournament up in Evansville. Some fine ladies. We didn't know they were good bowlers,
yeah,
though,
I did
we?
Not.
And they were representing us well up there in Evansville. This was the day in 1984 that former Lerman's employees, those who worked there from 1931 to 1966, got together for their second reunion down at the Colonial House. Of course, Lerman's was a big part of the downtown economic district in Glasgow with serving the public there and had a lot of folks that worked there. I'm glad they had
a great time.
Reunion. 1984, Tompkinsville Elementary School was honored on Earth Day up at Frankfort. Accepting the honor were members of the Tompkinsville Outdoor Learning Center Committee, including Dorothy Pear, Cecilia Stevens, Ken Johnson, Sheila Rush, Rhonda Thompson, Mike G., and Lewis Carter, some good Monroe Countyans, getting a well-deserved mm-hmm. honor there in 1994, Sam. 2004, the Barren County Progress reporting a big day in history where Barren County Middle School is naming Courtney Cruz as the new principal of Barren County mm-hmm. Middle School. I see Courtney from time to time. Now she's her offices are out at the Barren County Board of Education headquarters, and she's a wonderful educator.
Yes, an admirable person.
And 2014, this was the day the Barren County Veterans Association stepped forth with a new leader, that being Daryl Pickett. Daryl replacing Bobby Travis following his recent death. Now, let's talk about Lucky. You know, there was Bobby Travis was a great leader, and to have somebody of the quality of Daryl Pickett to step in and take over what Bobby had started, we've all been lucky in having some having that continue, I guess is what I'm saying.
We certainly are, and I'm sure that the Barren County Veterans Association is already hard at work preparing for the Memorial Day ceremonies in just a few weeks here in our community.
Sam, thank you for being here with us today. Thanks to some of the folks who do some of the digging, like Sandy Claywell and Marcia Latera, June Jackson, and Kay Harbison, all volunteers, and all who would like to meet you if you want to learn about history and volunteer to help get some of this stuff done. Check them out at the South Central Kentucky Cultural Center. We'll resume tomorrow, sir.
I'll see you then.